Hello and welcome to my channel, or welcome back to my channel. I'm going to try and multitask today. I'm going to try and do makeup while talking about disabled related things. So, wish me luck. I'm going to start straight in with the eyes. And I've been able to bring you closer than ever before. Thanks to that tripod I've got. So the thing I'm going to talk about today is disabled travel. I had thought about this a couple of weeks ago, well, kind of ever since I went to Tenerife, but I never got round to filming it because I had stuff that I thought might be more interesting. I definitely forgot about it for a little while. And then I thought about it again, and then coronavirus happened, so a lot of people won't be really travelling abroad, but I thought I'd share, like for a while, I thought I'd share what I've learned about, you know, flying abroad for a holiday. One of the easiest things you can do, especially if you're newly disabled or you've been disabled for a while but you haven't flown, is just simply just Google disabled travel. It really is that simple. So I did my own research online like that. And then with Tom's help, we decided to, you know, narrow it down to exactly which kind of hotel we wanted. And you know, what steps we wanted to take. I also was able to find a travel blog of somebody who was in a wheelchair. I think she traveled on her own and she went to Tenerife as well. So I thought, you know, obviously that's a good place to start. We're very lucky because Tenerife is actually quite a disabled access friendly place to travel to. And by that I mean their curbs and their pavements, they've got a lot of, like, it's made of definitely like tarmac built into the road, where they just put like a sort of small ramp, so instead of having like, I can only speak for in England, those, what do they call it? A drop curb. So that's a dip in the curb where you just can cross the road easily. Instead of having that in Tenerife, they have just built in with a tarmac, a very small ramp. So some of them are different sizes to others, some of them are a bit more steep than others. But it was pretty easy for me to drive from the pavement onto the road to cross and then back up on the other side. So that's really handy. Another thing in Tenerife is that the beach, they have at least one beach that is, has disabled access too. But by that I mean it's got, you know, a little, like, the walkway that's made of like wooden planks. It goes pretty close to the beach. So that is what we did for one of the days. The day we ended up going, or maybe just the time of the year, it wasn't really hot enough to go in the sea without freezing. And it was quite a windy day. So, you know, we went in January. I swear as well, I'm sure in December is actually warmer than January. So, yeah, that was good. There's disabled access on the beach. And You can also get mobility scooters that have these ugly massive blue, what look like inflatable tires. I think I might have mentioned that in a previous video, but I forget. And they can get you right down to the waterfront. I think they as well go into the sea, which is pretty cool. I couldn't see anywhere to hire that while I was there. One thing I forgot to reiterate in this video is that we were able to bring my mobility scooter on the plane to Tenerife, and I just used my own while we were there. There are places you can hire it from if you need them. There's places that if you want to hire it from England, if you don't have your own, including normal wheelchairs, you can do that too. I searched, you know, what was the protocol for taking my mobility scooter with me, and here in England, most of the major airlines allow you to take your mobility scooter as long as it's not over a certain size. It has the dimensions. You have to state the dimensions when you're telling them that you're taking it as well. They don't charge you. So we flew by TUI and we had no problems. They didn't actually, like Tom could tell, I don't know what he saw that I couldn't see, but they didn't even fold down my scooter, even though I have the small travel one that you can take apart. To put that in the hold. This is so pigmented. I'm using the BH Cosmetics Zodiac, what's it called? Zodiac Love Signs palette. I've had this palette for a long time. It's great. I just don't use it as much as I would like, because unfortunately I have 50 billion palettes. I'm going in with the green Aquarius. And I'm just trying to soften out the top because I went in too hard with the green. Just lightening it by just buffing it a lot. There's some fallout, if you can see. There we go, you can see there's a little bit of green down there. We had to call the airline to tell them when we were travelling, they were taking a mobility scooter, what the dimensions were, what the weight was, and what type of battery it has. Which I believe is called a dry cell battery. Because there's some batteries you can't take on a plane no matter what. And there's some that you can. We have the type, luckily, that we can. And then we knew it because we've looked before for taking it on a coach. There was that. Another thing you have to do is contact the hotel. Like, we checked out the hotel we wanted had was disabled, you know, access. Blah, blah, blah. It was mobility friendly, so it's completely accessible. I could bring my mobility scooter right down to the pool, which was fabulous. I did like the bare minimum walking, of course, because, you know, if I could walk, I wouldn't need a mobility scooter. I can walk, but it causes a lot of pain, like a lot of pain. It's not worth it, so I just don't walk as much as possible. Alright. We let the hotel know that this is the time we're coming. I have a mobility scooter because walking is difficult, and we asked as well, if it's not too late, could we have a disabled access room? We couldn't really find how to book that specifically on the website, or it said like to double check with the hotel. So like we booked it, paid for it, and then contacted the hotel. And then they said, yeah, that's no problem. And this is the room you're in. And it was basically a one bed apartment that was wheelchair accessible. If you have a somewhat more minor disability like me, and by that I mean you don't need a wheelchair, I mean you can walk a little bit without a wheelchair like I can, rather than you have no use of your legs, I would advise getting a wheelchair accessible room. There was loads of space for the scooter. I scooted right into the living room and just left it there, because it was like the biggest room besides the bedroom. I didn't want to risk knocking it or accidentally kicking it in the middle of the night going to the toilet. Just gently wiping away the green. Should probably use a wet wipe, not tissue, but I think I brought my wet wipes. Yep, this is just smudging down there. I normally have wet wipes in here. So one thing I forgot to check before starting. I do have my cellar water though. Don't I? My little tart one. One before. And I do have, fortunately, let's move it there. I do have cotton buds, so I'm gonna use that. So back to the story. One thing you should do as well. Oh yeah, the point I was making about the hotel is that it was great because I use a wheelchair accessible one. A wheelchair accessible bathroom is everything. Because I said, you know, it might be too late by the time we contact them, but I think it was just like a week before we were going. If there isn't a wheelchair accessible hotel ready, could at least, is it possible to find a stool maybe that I can rent or something so I can sit while I shower? That's what I do here. You may remember from previous video, if you've seen any of my previous fibromyalgia videos, that I sit down when I shower because I have no strength left in my legs and that to, I have no core strength as well to stand just for the time it takes to shower. I can't stand for the time it takes to brush my teeth as well. And there was a stool, which was great. And there was also those big bars that they have. They're sort of like, what do they get? So like this kind of shape. It's sort of like, you know, like the more than less than signs, but like rounded rather than pointed. And those are like the sort of bars. They have them in the shower and in by the toilet, so I could easily lift myself up, lower myself down for both showering and using the toilet if I needed. And it was great. I need one of those bars definitely in the shower as well. I think that'd be super helpful. So I just rolling up my sleeves a bit more. What I'm gonna do is actually, this is I'm gonna use some glitter, of course, a shimmery shade. Just get some. No, I dropped the missile of water. No. Nuts. I am like super tired today. I have a really low mood as well. Nothing's happened, I just feel really low, which happens sometimes. Sometimes there's not a reason for it, even though, you know, I'm taking all my meds and stuff. still on a waiting list to get back into counselling. Part of the reason I have a low mood though is because I've been thinking more about my weight and stuff. So I'm starting dieting. I decided not to do keto this time because the last couple of times I tried to diet, that's what I was doing. I'm going back to the 5-2 diet, which is an intermittent fasting, which is a proven way to lose weight if you can stick to it. So this is my fast day where I have to try and eat no more than 600 calories, which means I'm hungry. But yeah, another thing that is important to do when you travel, if you're like me, is to take your meds with you. Now, I have trouble sleeping. I have a type of insomnia that's called delayed phase sleep syndrome. So that means I can sleep, but I struggle to sleep at an appropriate hour, which you might know. I tend to sleep around... Where did I put that missile of water? Oh, so sorry. I tend to sleep around 4 a.m. ish to about 2 or 3 p.m. If I've had IBS, or if I've had just a lot of nausea, doesn't have to be IBS, then I get extra tired and I sleep towards 12 hours a night. So before I went, I got my prescriptions renewed because they were due to run out anyway while I was away. And so I got my regular stuff sorted, and then I spoke to her about my sleep problems. I explained this is the type of insomnia I have. Some of my meds do make me drowsy, but the problem is they don't help me to get to sleep any earlier, no matter how early I take them. If I take them, say, 2 in the afternoon, give me a couple of hours and I'll fall asleep. But sometimes I take them and it doesn't have that effect. I don't know why. I'm just lucky, I guess. So my doctor put me on Ambient for a short period of time, so that I wanted it while I was away so that I could be able to get to sleep pretty early. Sleep. Have a good night's sleep still, and then wake up not too late. And it worked. While I was away, I was in bed, I think I was out by like 1 o'clock, sometimes earlier. And then I was only sleeping about 8 hours. A couple of days I needed to nap, which are not unusual for me. So that was good. I forgot to put more concealer back on my eye. So make sure you have your prescriptions. If you have any issues that you need to discuss before you go on a holiday like me, if you feel that they might be able to prescribe you a sleeping tablet if that's your problem, do that before you go. I took a letter with me that confirms my diagnosis of fibro, and I took a copy of my script as well to prove that this, if somebody asks, this is the medication I am prescribed. Just make sure it's all legal. You don't want to get in trouble, especially if you're like me and you're carrying quite a lot of painkillers. And I carry Tramadol, which is a pretty strong narcotic. So yeah, I sorted that before we went. It never came up. I keep what painkillers I need in my handbag for the flight, and then I kept the bulk of them in my suitcase. So that was that. One thing I learned in Tenerife as well is, unfortunately, the best way to get around is buses. However, a lot of the buses are not wheelchair accessible and it's hard to know which ones are and which ones aren't. And they're not the buses that I have in England, they look more like coaches. Single-decker coaches. So to make matters easier, we took taxis more often than not. I think the whole time we took taxis, which was kind of expensive overall, but compared to what we pay in the UK with having a mobility scooter, it was a lot less. I'm just trying to, you know, blend the lines between so it doesn't just look like a weird block of a shimmer. I quite like that sort of spotlight or halo eye. I guess you could say it's a cut crease because I added more concealer, but it's not the correct shape, I don't think, but I like it. So I'm just gonna take the brush that I was using to blend the crease. I'm just gonna use it to soften that line there. Yeah, I think the taxis were about, from the hotel to the airport, which is say 20 minutes, I think, like 20 quid, which was not too bad at all. And there were some things that were close enough to the hotel that, you know, we, Tom walked and I scooted. I was gonna say we walked, but I didn't. And that was all handy. They had the taxi rank right outside the hotel, which is handy. So you just had to cross the road and, you know, get in the taxi and tell them where we're going. So that was great. Let me see, I've got my list here, what else do you need? Oh yeah, when you're travelling you might need to know certain words or phrases. But when we went to Italy, we both tried to learn some Italian before we went, like a couple of months or so in advance. We went on Duolingo and used that website to do lessons. If you don't know what Duolingo is, I suggest you check it out, it's pretty cool. I'm just trying to use, I clean most of my brushes but I forgot to do this one, so I was thinking like I need a small one to do my eyeliner at the bottom. This is a very green look. What I'll do first actually, I'll take my NYX green eyeliner pencil. This is a slide-on one. That's the name of it, slide-on eye pencil, I believe. In the colour Esmeralda. Ugh, I hate doing it like that. I feel I need to pull my eye down. In Tenerife, a lot of people do speak English. I guess because it's very touristy. There's a completely different shade of green to the rest, but I really like that. Looking through my viewfinder, it looks like the colour matches the eyeshadow more, but in this mirror, it's a completely different shade of green. Fill that in a bit more. Let's come close. Oh, I can see here. Little patch. That's what it looks like. So yeah, make sure you know the essentials, like where is the hospital? If you're like me on my first holiday to Tenerife when I was 26, I went alone. It was my second trip, the first one I went with Tom, which was 4 years ago. I got bit by a spider in the hotel. didn't realise I was having an allergic reaction to a spider bite. It was getting worse and worse, and then when I was like, okay, I can't bear this pain anymore, I think it'd been about 3 days. We were in Loro Park, which is like a zoo, but has a lot of parrots. That's like its specialty. We asked at the medical tent and they were like, that looks like a spider bite, you need to go and get medical help, like real medical help, more than they could provide there. And Tom needed to know how to say, my girlfriend has diarrhea from her antibiotics. Get medication for that. So this year we travelled with Imodium and then Buscopan in case I had any IBS related cramps. Just in case. Let me see. Is there anything else I've forgotten? Make sure, of course, you've got insurance. Check if, you know, with your disability type, if you need a specific type of, like, maybe medical insurance. I did not need that. And, you know, I got Tom to double check anything to make sure it wasn't missing out on any important information. And we did put down that I have fibromyalgia, but we still got pretty cheap insurance. I can't remember the exact amount, but it was like pretty cheap, which is, you know, always good. Next step I'm gonna do is just normal black liquid liner, I believe. I was thinking of using, like, I've got this NYX Vivid Brights liquid liner. I was thinking, like, should I use that? Would that be too much green? Would black look better? I don't know. Should we try the green, see how it looks? And then if it blends in too much that like you can't see it, maybe I'll just use the black after all. You can see I've got green on my nails already. Looks in kind of blue in this light. These are Barry M nail polish, which I'll include the details below. I got that like a year ago or so. So yeah, it was good that the insurance was inexpensive. A lot of the restaurants that we went to as well were either spacious enough that I could scoot right inside the restaurant, or I could just leave it outside and walk the few steps to a table. See, in this, I can see the green liner that I just did on top, and it does look pretty, but you can barely see it if I look straight ahead in this camera. But I like it. I like how it blends in. Can you see that? Yeah, I can see it in the camera. Let's just leave it like that. I'm gonna spoil it with some black eyeliner. I'm already gonna spoil it with some black mascara. And I don't think it's going to be spoiled. I'm going to pause, do the other eye off camera, and then do the mascara off camera, because there's only one way to do mascara. And I think it's pointless doing it on camera, but yeah. Okay, welcome back to my super zoomed face. As you can see, I've just done all of my makeup. Some of it did not go well, but looking in the viewfinder, I think my makeup looks great when I look into this mirror, it's like, no. I can just see, you know, everything that's wrong with my face. And I'm looking hella shiny. I realised as well, like, using the ring light in here, that my brow pencil is too light as usual. It's so hard for me to find the dark, because my hair is naturally dark brown. It's not black, it's very, very dark brown. But I think I might just have to wear black, use a black eye product, because like this one comes up way too light brown and a bit red toned, which is not, I don't hate the red tone that much because I have red in my hair naturally anyway. My hair's quite, like, it's dyed, it's supposed to be an intense purple, but it's looking quite red in certain lights. So, the rest of the makeup I used for my face will be down below. Back to the disabled travel portion. Let me zoom out because there's no need to be this close. Hang on. Oh yeah, hang on, have a look. My eye makeup. I decided to do a different colour. I used a minty green shade on this eye, and then what's supposed to be, or what looks like in the palette, a, like the this one next to it, the dark green, I used that for my right eye, and then this colour here, yeah, Capricorn, that's the shimmer shade on this eye. Aquarius, is I use the matte green. And then I use the corresponding shimmer green for Aquarius on this eye. But it's come out like a kind of a bluish silver colour. If I can close my eye enough for you to see. I'm gonna just close both eyes. It's weird. And then I used Scorpio, which is a very light pink, on my inner corner to contrast. So I swatched them on my hand as well, so you can see what the colours look like. So this is the Aquarius that was supposed to be a dark green shimmery eyeshadow, and it ended up looking more of a bluish colour. So here's a close up. Apologies if this scares you. And then that's the eyeshadow. It was me looking down, it's because I'm looking at my notes. Other things to think about. Give yourself obviously plenty of time to get to the airport, either side. I think they say it's like 2 or 3 hours for international travel. You can easily just Google that and check. I think it's 2 hours to get through customs. The good thing about being in a wheelchair or mobility scooter is that you get to come to the front of the queue, and obviously because Tom is with me as my carer slash fiance, he gets to cut the queue for, as well. So you just go to the you know, the customer service help desk in the airport, and you say, you know, I've booked assistance because I'm in a mobility scooter for this flight, blah, blah, blah. And then, you know, they'll get the staff there and take you where you need to go. So we went to the TUI desk at the front. They checked us all in. They boarding pass, took the suitcase. My mobility scooter went right up until like the last possible moment. And then there's this little mini bus type thing where you go on it and then it takes you, you know, to the plane. But this one was a weird one because it's like you go on it, this platform, and then it elevates you and then puts you in the thing. If I'm remembering correctly. But it's not like you just board a normal bus. And, you know, they make sure that you do as minimal walking as possible. And if you need help walking, like if you can't walk, they will arrange, you know, more help for you to get to the seat. But I can walk a few steps, so I did that. And then they sought to me for a wheelchair before this transport thing nothing came up. I'd go in a wheelchair and then staff will push you in the wheelchair to through, you know, the what's the thing called, you know, the big connecty thing. The little tunnel thing you go through and then you go onto the plane. You go and buy a wheelchair for that. Wait, that was after actually the little transport thing you go on to get to the plane. I don't know what these things are called. I should have looked them up. But anyway, so it's basically all taken care for you. You just tell them you're booked assistance and they just tell you what to do next. Which is like, you know, scoot all the way to this point and then they put you in a wheelchair at this point. You don't really have to think too much about it. Going through customs, you don't scoot through customs if you can walk. It might be different if you're in a wheelchair. The other person that was in a mobility scooter as well didn't put her scooter through. So they just take that round and you just walk through security thing quickly. You know, you take off all your shoes and put your electricals in the trays and stuff, and then you just walk through the scanner and that's it, and then you sit back down and that's it. Unless, you know, there's a complication, that should be it. For some reason, one of the times I didn't like Tom's CPAP machine, which is weird because they should know what it is, but it got flagged one time, which is dumb. So it says 2 hours before a domestic flight and around 3 hours for an international flight. Sometimes they say more if you're travelling at peak times. We flew, both of them were quite late flights. Well, the first one to Tenerife is afternoon, which is great because my sleep is messed up. I'm not an early riser and that. And then we got an even later one back. And both times we were flying as well, like the wind has blown coming towards the plane, so it slows you down a bit. So our flights took, I think it was an hour extra each way, which is awful if you're like me and you have pain. Like even just sitting here and talking, my back hurts right now. And I'm gonna get Tom to rub some quinoline oil on it. Oh, that's not how you pronounce it, but I'm sorry for butchering it. I'm not Oriental. I'd say Chinese, but I'm not sure if it is Chinese or not, so. Anyway. We also took, obviously, the charger for the scooter, but the instruction manual just in case something went very wrong. Or just in case we had to show how we know, you know, what the battery type is and all those kind of technical stuff that they asked for earlier. So I will link below a couple of websites that I found particularly helpful, and you know, if you have any more questions, feel free to message below. If not, you know, please like and subscribe if you haven't already. Ring the bell because I upload quite infrequently depending on my pain and tiredness, as you know. And you might not want to miss my videos or not, I don't know. Also follow me on Instagram. My Instagram, I post more frequently than I do on YouTube. That's it. Thanks for joining me. Bye!